When I went to a university and began planning my studies, I chose some courses specifically because I thought they would be easy credits and you need study credits to get a degree. One of the courses I chose was Introduction to Logic 1. As a programmer with background in digital electronics, I thought I am fairly well set for propositional logic. After my experiences with Introduction to Logic 1, I chose Introduction to Logic 2 because I thought predicate logic can't be that different from propositional logic, and I also know the philosophical foundations of logic. After all, logic is logic is logic, right? In our life, we are often faced with choices, such as, do we enter the left door or do we enter the right door? In programming, we deal with this kind of decisions with the if statement. In this case, the program may choose exactly one of these paths. If the left door was entered, it performs the affirmative actions. If the right door was entered, it performs the negative actions. There are clearly only two options. However, sometimes decisions are more complex. In this scenario from Hogan's Alley, you have the decision to fire the zapper or not to fire the zapper. However, what happens depends on when you fire the gun. If you fire the zapper when there is a professor, you lose the round. If you fire the zapper when there is not a professor, nothing happens. If you don't fire the zapper when there is a professor, nothing happens. If you don't fire the zapper when there is not a professor, nothing happens. In other words, if you fire the zapper and there is a professor, you lose the round. Both conditions have to be true for this to happen. Neither condition alone will do it. This AND condition is called a conjunction. In the circuit diagrams of digital electronics, the conjunction is represented by a box with an ampersand on it, or a shape that resembles the letter D, depending on which convention you follow, the International Electrotechnical Commission standard, or the one that originates from the United States military. Whatever the case, it works like this. If no power flows in, output Q emits no power. If power flows in from input A, output Q emits no power. If power flows in from input B, output Q emits no power. If power flows in from both A and B, then power flows out from output Q. In other words, power flows out if power flows in from all inputs. A truth table is a convenient way to express what happens in each output in every possible combination of inputs. There are multiple possible layouts to the truth table, and I chose this one. Why is it called a truth table? In this table, I used the symbols 0 and 1 to mark no and yes, but the standard way is to say false and true. We might mark them with F and T letters, or we might use the logical truth value symbols, but the number notation is most readable in my opinion, so we will stick with that. In this scenario from Super Mario Bros., when Mario is small and he walks into an enemy, he perishes. However, if Mario is big and he walks into an enemy, he suffers damage but survives. If Mario has firepower and he walks into an enemy, he suffers damage but survives. If Mario is big and has firepower and he walks into an enemy, he suffers damage but survives. In other words, Mario survives if he is big or if he has a power-up. This OR condition is called a disjunction. In digital electronics, we represent it with these symbols. If no power flows in, output Q emits no power. If power flows in from input A, then power flows out from output Q. If power flows in from input B, then power flows out. If power flows in from both A and B, then power flows out. In other words, output is true if any of the inputs is true. In Solar Jetman, if you have the shield activated, then you cannot tow items. If you don't have the shield activated, then you can tow items. In digital electronics, we represent this sort of operation called negation using one of these two symbols. It has a very simple truth table. Simply, power goes out if no power comes in. If power goes in, then no power comes out. By now, we have covered three very important and basic logic operations, the conjunction, the disjunction, and the negation. One could say that several of the remaining are just various combinations of these three. The Schiffer stroke, better known as the NAND gate, is a combination of the conjunction and the negation. It works exactly like the AND gate, but its output is inverted. In other words, its output is always true unless all of its inputs are true. The same goes for the Pierce's arrow, better known as the NOR gate, which is a combination of the disjunction and the negation. Its output is only true if all of the inputs are false. It's like an inverted AND gate! If you made this observation on your own, then you are very good. These two circuits are in fact identical, even though one looks more complicated than the other. Let's prove this case by case. First, assume that A and B are both false. This means that P1 and P2 will both be true. This satisfies the AND gate, so Q2 will also be true. And as we established earlier, the NOR puts out a true signal in this case as well. Now assume that A is true. This will turn P1 into false because of the negation. Now the AND is no longer satisfied, so Q2 will be false. The same goes when B is true. If both A and B are true, then both P1 and P2 will be false because of their respective negations, and the AND can't possibly be satisfied, so Q1 will be false too. And now you can see that both circuits have the same truth table. They are therefore said to be logically equivalent. This is an important equality to keep in mind, as it helps a lot when optimizing your logical expressions. This law called De Morgan's law also holds true if you exchange the NORs and the NANDs. These two circuits are logically equivalent too. The rules can be written in English like this. The negation of a disjunction is the conjunction of the negations, and the negation of a conjunction is the disjunction of the negations. Once again, I have provided two alternative notations that express the same thing. I find the one on the right side more concise and easier to read, but the one on the left is what we used in the university. Another interesting thing is that NOR gates alone can be used to build every other logic gate in existence. For example, you can create a NOT gate simply by tying the inputs of the NOR together. You can create an OR gate by inverting the output of the NOR with a NOT gate, and we already learned how to make a NOT. And you can create an AND gate by invoking De Morgan's law. The same also goes for NAND. It is equally universal. If you have a chance to play MRD someday, check it out. In that game you gradually build an entire microprocessor from nothing but NAND gates. Now, moving on with our logic operators, next on our list is the equivalence, also called material conditional. This one looks simple. We are simply testing whether two things match, right? 3 equals 3, that's true. 1 equals 1, that's true. 1 equals 2, that's false. False equals false, that's true. False equals true, that's false. True equals false, that's also false. True equals true, yes, that's true. This operation can be constructed from basic elements. You could express it in disjunctive normal form, or in conjunctive normal form, or build it from nothing but NOR gates, or from nothing but NAND gates. Not that you would ever want to, but it's possible. The symbol for equivalence is left-right arrow in propositional logic, and in algebraic notation it is an encircled dot operator. The inverse of equivalence is non-equivalence. This is better known as the exclusive disjunction or the XOR operation. It expresses an either-or condition. If either A is true or B is true but not both, then Q is true. This operation pops up sometimes when programming with binary numbers, but other than that, it is fairly uncommon, and our courses in the university skipped it altogether. The symbol for XOR is the conjunction symbol that looks like V, except it's underlined. In algebraic notation, it is an encircled plus sign. The circuit symbols for the exclusive disjunctions are like this. The markings reminisce of an OR gate, but it's an exclusive OR where only one of the inputs may be true. The circuit symbol for the equivalence is similar, but with an inverter circle added at the end. Because these two gates are logically opposites of each other's, and the exclusive disjunction is called XOR, the equivalence is sometimes called XNOR, with an N added to indicate negation. It is also sometimes called XAND, exclusive AND. This is reflected in the algebraic symbols of these two gates. The OR is a plus sign and the AND is a multiplication dot. The exclusive OR is an encircled plus sign and the equivalence is an encircled multiplication dot, because in a way it is an exclusive AND. The material implication, also known as material conditional, weirded me out for longest time during the past decades. It is a built-in operator in the basic programming language and I couldn't figure out what for. It's written with a right arrow and it reads like this: if A then B. So how does this work? Let me guess. If A then B, so let's put 1 for A and B. If not A, then B must be false, right? Let's put 0 for both A and B. Now remember that this is a propositional operator. It does not state anything about the inputs. It reads inputs, judges the proposition, and the result is whether the proposition holds or not. We have so far come up with two situations where the implication holds, so we can put true in both of these rows. Now what happens if A is true and B is not true? This is a clear contradiction with the implication. The implication says that if A, then B. However, B is false, so the implication is false. Finally, what if A is false and B is true? In this case, the implication is true. Let me explain why, in plain English. Suppose you have a house and you have a dog. Now let's make a proposition. If there is a thief on the lawn, then the dog will bark. Now suppose that a thief is approaching your house. Will the dog bark? Of course the dog will bark. But what if the dog does not bark? It is impossible. The dog will bark if there is a thief on the lawn. The combination of a thief on the lawn and the dog not barking is impossible. Now suppose there is no thief. What if the dog barks? That might happen. The dog might still bark, because that's what dogs do. How about if the dog does not bark? That is also possible. The dog might not feel like barking. Most dogs do not bark all day. Now, if there is a thief, can we conclude that the dog will be barking? Yes, this conclusion is called modus ponens. If A implies B and A is true, then B must be true. How about if the dog is barking, can we conclude that there is a thief? We cannot. The dog might bark whether there is a thief or not. But if the dog is not barking, can we conclude that there is no thief? Yes, we can make that conclusion. This conclusion is called modus tollens. If A implies B, but B is false, then A must be false. The material implication is a very important concept when logic meets philosophy, and there is even a special name for the two components of this proposition. The first half of the proposition is called an antecedent, and the second half is called the consequent. Antecedent is the premise, and the consequent is the conclusion. The implication can be expressed as a disjunction between the consequent and the negation of the antecedent. Now let's make a summary of all of this. This is propositional logic. It means that we have a proposition that is some sort of a claim or idea that is expressed as a formula, and then we can judge whether that claim is true or false. For negation, the proposition is that input is false. The proposition is true when B is false and false otherwise. For conjunction, the proposition is that all inputs are true. The proposition is true when A and B are both true and false otherwise. For disjunction, the proposition is that at least one of the inputs is true. The proposition is true when A is true or B is true and false if both are false. For equivalence, the proposition is that all inputs are equivalent. The proposition is true when A and B have the same value and false otherwise. For exclusive disjunction, the proposition is that exactly one input is true. The proposition is true when A is true or B is true, but not when neither or both are true. For implication, the proposition is that the antecedent implies the consequent. The proposition is true when A implies B and false otherwise. Now, throughout this video, I have alternatively used different notation for these operations. Sometimes I have marked the conjunction with an upside down V, sometimes with a multiplication dot, and sometimes without. Same goes for every other operator covered in this lesson, except for the implication. On this slide you can see some of these commonly used alternative notations, and there is more in the left edge of the screen. This is because logic is a very cross-sectional field. What we have covered here is called propositional logic, but it is also called Boolean algebra. Computer scientists use it, electrical engineers use it, mathematicians use it, philosophers use it, and even within mathematics, the group theory has many similarities to Boolean algebra. Within these different branches, different notations have grown to express the same things. Because personally I have background in all of these areas, I also use these notations interchangeably and switch between them depending on context. I am sorry if that causes confusion, but throughout this series I stick to only the notations marked in red on this page, with preference towards the mathematical notation, except in the next episode in which I talk about Carnot maps. In part 2 we will continue from here with the Carnot map and conclusions and fallacies. See you soon again and have a nice day.